everyone. Thank you for attending. Please join me in saluting the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. We start off our meeting with a hearing of visitors. I see that we have two people that have signed in. Lisa Sinkowitz, please come up. Hi, Lisa, welcome.
Thank you. Mr. Minicello, Superintendent Smith, members of the school committee, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight, as you did last month at the hearing in regards to the transition of the Gilmore School to the Barrett Russell Building. I unfortunately wasn't able to be here at the voting 2 weeks ago. I was instead sitting bedside at my oldest son's, in my oldest son's hospital room, waiting for the word on that decision to get to me. And one would think that waiting to find answers on his health after 10 years of unexplained seizures would kind of lessen the devastation of your vote. It didn't, and I'm here tonight to let you know that it didn't. I don't know how each of you voted. To those of you who listened to the heartfelt cries of the parents that came out a month ago, thank you. And for those of you who made your decision based on other factors, I'm sorry. It is unfortunate that you did not listen to the community who came out that evening, where they painted the picture of exactly what was breaking up with that transition of the Gilmore School to the new location of the Barrett Russell School. It's unfortunate for the students of the Gilmore School. However, as a parent of one of those students, I actually find it disgusting that you didn't listen to that community of parents. They came here to share their hearts that night to you. Not only are they the parents of those students, but that's the same community that voted you into the positions you hold. The positions that you are supposed to represent said community that you live in. I'm disheartened to think that there may be more than meets the eye to this transition. And I can't help but still question the validity, Superintendent, that this transition is a solution to your budget. I feel completely misled by you at the meeting you had at the Gilmore School last month. And if I may say something about the budget, generally speaking, you cannot claim, as you did in the last hour, Superintendent, that Brockton kids count, and then turn around and make a decision or allow a vote to happen where only some of Brockton kids count. You're disregarding some of Brockton's most vulnerable with this vote. I have to say that for the first time since enrolling my students in the Brockton Public Schools, I fear that our children and their interests are not kept by the leadership of this school system. And I question just who will fight for the underdogs of the Brockton Public Schools, which is the reason why I came tonight, so that you know your decision does not tread lightly on our hearts, and that perhaps you will search deep in your own hearts to find the right solution for this budget. Because it is not right for these children what you voted. I came here tonight to speak to those who recommended and voted the move of the Gilmore School for two reasons. To let you know that the parents and the community feel failed by you. And also to implore you to overturn that vote. This decision is not ethical, it is not responsible, it is not fiscally right, and it's not fair. And it certainly does not harbor the best interests of the students in this community. I'm confident that votes have been changed in the past, and I implore you to review this vote and overturn it. Thank you.
You want to say anything or not? Helen Verga, please.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Helen Verga, and I am the retired principal of the Gilmore Early Childhood Center, as you know. I'm also a resident, taxpayer, and voter. I'm here to let you know my concerns regarding the school moves voted on 2 weeks ago. And as you know, I'm especially concerned about the plan to move the Gilmore children to the Barrett Russell, a school that does not meet their needs. Thank you, Tim, Lisa, and Joyce for voting for these children and their families. I want to add that this was not a vote for all Brockton children. That's not true. It was not a vote for the Gilmore children. The vote gives the Gilmore children less. And how the vote was taken with no recommendation by the Facilities Committee. My first concern is Superintendent's Facilities Plan, of which these moves are the first steps. One might think that a plan to move over 1,200 children that involves four buildings would need careful consideration, thoughtful planning, and occur after months of preparation. It would happen only after much informed discussion, not only with the school committee, but with the public. After being mentioned in January at the school committee retreat, staff were told by the superintendent in February about the moves, family meetings were held by the end of February, and the vote on a motion was taken in March. So these decisions were made in less than 3 months. Does that sound like careful consideration and thoughtful planning to you? Brockton Public Schools will now house its three neediest populations, 3 and 4 year olds, 50% of whom have disabilities, the students with emotional impairments, and the students in need of alternate placements in the three oldest buildings, the Barrett Russell built in 1925, the Huntington in 1896, and the Keith in 1915. So this facilities plan gives the oldest and least in facilities to the neediest, most vulnerable, and most disabled students. My second concern is what the Gilmore children and their families lose. There will be no more monthly events during the school day at the Gilmore in the cafeteria. These events are part of the school culture. The December paper plate dance was my personal favorite. There's no space for these events at the Barrett Russell. Other family events like Spooky Night, the Sweetheart Spaghetti Supper, use both the gym and the cafeteria. Even if you add parking spaces, you will not have parking for 150 cars. And the all-purpose room is too small to accommodate these functions. And there is no gym. The annual school events that families participate in, such as the Halloween Parade, Special Olympics, School Fun Day, Family Fun Day, and Closing Ceremony Day, utilize the fenced and gated rear parking lot, the fenced grassy area behind the school, as well as the cafeteria, gym, and playground, all at the same time. These events are at the heart of family engagement. These events can't happen at the Barrett Russell. There is simply not enough space. Moving the assessment team to the Adult Learning Center because of lack of space is one of the most detrimental results of the move. It's hardly been spoken of. Anyone who knows how this team functions and its impact on families would never suggest such a move. The whole process should happen at the Early Childhood Center. This is what is best for families. I don't have time to go into detail here, but I can excuse whoever thinks this is a good idea by believing they really don't know how the intake process at the Gilmore works. I do. My third concern is fiscal responsibility. It's going to be expensive to give the Gilmore children less. Over $100,000 for the playground and sway fund. How much will sinks and bathrooms cost? And I shouldn't have to remind you that additional bathrooms and sinks in every classroom is not a privilege, but a necessity. And parking for staff. Right now, there are 38 parking spots for over 70 staff. As a resident, taxpayer, and voter, I would like to tour the Barrett Russell in September. As the retired principal, I still have close connections with families and staff. I'll be looking for sinks, additional bathrooms, a new certified playground, a sway fund, enough parking spaces for staff. Of course, there'll be two less classrooms, no gym, no cafeteria, no spaces for therapies and adapted phys ed, but you are voting for all the children. I didn't see the expenses of updating the Gilmore kitchen for the Huntington children factored into the cost of these moves. I was told that's over $100,000. How is this fiscally responsible? Someone mentioned that 56 Goddard students will be able to utilize all three floors of the Huntington School. That's 18 students per floor. How can the cost of running a school that holds 575 students for 56 students be economically feasible? Again, I ask, where's the careful consideration and thoughtful planning for such an enormous and expensive move that impacts so many students and their families? Next, you'll be saying the move will save $1 million. You can manipulate the figures to say whatever you want them to say. And I know there's a huge deficit. I understand that. Please do not forget the real cost of moving the Huntington School to the Gilmore is being paid for by the Gilmore children. I believe we're measured by how we take care of those who have the least. In Brockton Public Schools, those who have the least are its youngest. The superintendent's recommendation and the four members who approved the motion sent a clear message to Gilmore families and to all of us. Brockton kids count, just not the youngest ones.
I'm not going to get into the details of, you know, what was just said. However, you know, this community and this committee and administration is always open to discussion with parents and staff, and we will do the right thing with respect to making sure the students have what they need going forward. We take what we do to heart. We are in a situation where very difficult decisions, unfortunately, need to be made. And that's all I'll say. We have the next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. The consent agenda is a gathering of routine business. The school committee has the opportunity to remove any item that they would like to discuss in further detail. Is there any item that any of the members would like to consider and discuss? No? Okay. Then could someone please present a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay. Communications, report of the superintendent of schools. Madam Superintendent?
Yes, under communications, we received from student researchers at Stonehill College a request to meet with school committee members to discuss policies in the Brockton Public Schools. I believe they're doing a research project, so we'll make sure that you have this communication. I know Wanda will be available if you could come up with a time where you could meet with this group of students. She'll put you in touch with them. But we did receive communications asking for school committee members to take part in their research study. Okay, and under the report of the superintendent of schools, the first thing that I would like to talk about is a diversity task force that we have had probably going on since October of this year. We started to bring community members together along with school members to talk about the diversity of our staffing in our community. And one of the things that we continue to talk about is a grow your own program. And a grow your own program is, again, not bringing in people from, you know, other communities. Of course, they're welcome, but to also look at our own students. We've had very good luck with our students that are encouraged to go into teaching, that come back. They're the teachers in our schools, they're the coaches, they work in the drama, they work in the music department, they work in many of the extracurricular activities. So we put together our very own video. We had Lynn Tartaglia, and I do see Lynn in the audience. And we have a number of members of our teachers, and not everybody is here. Yasmina Carvalho, I know we have Brian Cassell here, Brian. Okay, I see Brian down back. Manny DeBarros is not here, but Bob Hogan, I see Bob Hogan there. Carlito Weaver, Carlito, I saw you, very good. Allison McDonald, Allison. And we also had Julie Belcher, who does our Educator Rising, our Future Teacher Club, and Matt Cunningham that couldn't be here tonight as part of that video. I would like to actually invite, we want to show you the video, but I would like to invite Dr. Moran down here, who heads up our diversity task force. And I know I see a number of members here. If you could stand up, and I don't know if you want to send a representative down. Mr. Bernard, I see you. Jacob Tagger is a commissioner on the City Commission. Angel Cosme is, again, not only one of our teachers in Brockton, new teacher in Brockton, but also part of our Diversity Commission. And anybody else that is part of the commission, please feel free to come down. So we want to unveil this video to you. And ironically, I will tell you this. One of the things that we have been talking about is an educator fair in our own community. There are times we go to other communities to try to encourage people to come to our community as future educators in Brockton. So obviously, those of you that heard us talking about the finances, we didn't want to take a step back. We are going to be talking about an April fair. It is going to be more of a networking, meet our diversity task force, and start to talk about, as you so nicely put, Mr. Minicello, all that is good about the Brockton Public Schools and certainly working in the city of Brockton. And that is going to be on Thursday, April 27th. 4 to 7 p.m. Dr. Moran, you want to tell us a little bit more about it, or?
I'd be happy to, except you've listened to me a couple of times now, so I brought some of my friends with me, and Jacob and I are going to switch seats, and Angel's going to speak.
Okay. So I'll just talk a little bit about the Diversity Task Force. As Superintendent Smith said, it's been around since October, which is the effect of a number of community organizations coming together, Brockton Interfaith, the NAACP, the Haitian Community Partners, Cape Verdean Association, and of course the district, to look at the issue of diversity at the district. And since then, we've done a number of things. I think one of the things that gave us a little bit of clarity is the statement of purpose, which I'll read so that everybody's sort of clear what the task force intends to do. So the Diversity Task Force statement of purpose is to substantially increase the diversity within the BPS by establishing policies and procedures that will help to create a resource of candidates from numerous ethnic backgrounds for hire as educators, administrators, operational support, and other positions of employment. The initial emphasis will be placed on increasing the pool of educators and administrators. And I'll also read the Diversity Task Force mission statement, which is to establish a BPS diversity recruitment and retention program that is designed with policies and procedures in place to ensure employment respective and relative to the demographics of the student population. So since October, some of the things that the committee has successfully implemented or discussed or is in the process of looking at is getting some input from a consultant to look at our diversity practices and to give us some best practices and some strategies to diversify our workforce. Of course, Superintendent Smith said the recruitment and networking fair, which is happening on April 27th, will also be taking place from 4 to 7 p.m. We've looked at the hiring process within the district. Of course, I mentioned the mission statement and the purpose. And what I guess, I think what we're going to do now is premiere a diversity video that sort of highlights the importance of having a workforce that is diverse and the benefit to both students of color and students not of color. There's a mutual benefit to diversity. This video highlights that. It shows the benefit of really hiring teachers and future educators from Brockton, and the district and the community are working together. I think what we need are solutions. Oftentimes, we know what the problems are, but in addition to problem solving the problems, we need to really come up with some tangible solutions. And I think that's what the purpose of this committee is intended to do.
I want to say something real quick. Sure. I just wanted to thank Dr. Moran and her team. As somebody who hasn't been involved in this process, it's been eye-opening. I also want to thank Superintendent Smith. We've had some tough conversations, but it's been open conversations. And I just wanted to tell you, Dr. Moran, I appreciate. I was fortunate enough to be involved in the hiring process recently of a young Brockton woman, a qualified applicant. I want to say she was hired as an MTA, but it was just eye-opening for somebody like myself who's not, doesn't have the experience of how the hiring process in the schools works. It was very eye-opening, and I just really appreciate you allowing me to be a part of it. And I just want to make sure I again thank your team, Dr. Moran, and Superintendent Smith. Like I said, we've had some uncomfortable conversations, but it's everything has been very constructive. I'm just so anxious to be part of really again promoting Brockton, letting future employees or applicants know about our school system, and to just try to work with Brockton Public Schools to address this issue. So I just wanted to thank you, Superintendent Smith, and of course, Dr. Moran, and if anybody's ever had any cookies that they bring to these meetings, the cookies are the best. So thank you.
Okay, so I think we're ready to premiere the video.
first thing I wanted to do was come back and serve my community.
Coming up through the Brockton Public School System prepared me for life in general.
I'm a fourth generation Brocktonian, proud to be back teaching in the city of Chandler.
You know, there certainly are no better students than the students that we graduate from our Brockton Public Schools. And to see them when I go from the littlest children in the preschool to our elementary, to our middle and our high school, it is the best part of my day to see what these students do each and every day. You know, they give back to the community. They're working hard in their classes. They are our best teachers. They come in, they've lived in the community, they understand the concerns of their neighbors. Many times you find that they're athletes, so they're the coaches. You know, they're all of a sudden working with the dance team, the halftime show. You know, they've been in the band. They come back and perform all of those extra curricular type things which truly make us the district that we are.
I think it's important to have Brocktonians teaching in our school system because Brockton is such a unique city. It's very diverse. It is a melting pot, if you will, of all different cultures, all different people. And I think it's really important to have people who know that demographic, people who came from this city and understand how special the city is, to come back and to teach those students, because we're proud of our city, and that's something that I think we need to continue to be able to do. And if we empower our youth with people who graduated from the city, I think it's going to make all the better for us.
I coach football, indoor track, outdoor track. I'm heavily involved in the community. I believe it's extremely important that people who are from the community come back to the community and not only give back, but you know, try to lead the next generation of leaders in order to become a better community and a stronger community.
I want to give back to the community, but more importantly, I want to give back to the youth. I feel like we have a wonderful youth that live in Brockton that just really needs to be motivated and feel like someone believes in them. And so really, for me, it was more about coming back and helping give each generation their, you know, a voice.
One thing I really love about teaching in Brockton is interacting with these kids that, from an outside point of view, people see them as problem child, and or that they're not going to overcome whatever life is throwing at them. But dealing with the students I have and teaching them and interacting with them, really see that the fight that they have in them is so pure that they're not going to let anything in life stop them from achieving whatever goal that they set forward. And that's the one great thing about Brockton, is they always welcome back their own with open arms, and they always believe that no matter what, a Brocktonian can fight through whatever life dishes them and come back stronger and more successful.
It's giving back to the school that gave you so much. You don't realize how much the city of Brockton and Brockton High School gives you until you leave. While we say as seniors, oh, I can't wait to get out of here, I can't wait to get out of here, but then when you start to go through your college life and meet other, you know, kids from other towns, you kind of find out that you had it really good at Brockton High School. And you find out that the cultural diversity is a huge factor in your life, and being exposed to that as a young person and having that be a part of your life every day as an adult is something that Brockton High School teaches you. So if you are interested in becoming a teacher, in that sense, you should want to give back to the school that gives you so much. And again, a lot of people don't realize it until after they graduate.
Teaching at Brockton High School has been such a great opportunity and is truly one of the best places to work as a teacher, because not only do we have 4,500 students that attend this high school, we have a talent pool that is unlike any other school.
We need to do a better job of encouraging our young people to go into the field of education. Where we're encouraging kids to join our so-called Future Teachers Clubs, our Educators Rising, and we're starting at a middle school level and building up to a high school level. Where a curriculum is developed, we talk about the profession, we talk about the career, we talk about those particular traits that will make you a good teacher.
It's very important for kids to realize that they can give back to the community even just by being a teacher. And I say just by being a teacher because it sounds simple, but really it is a lot, and you inspire a lot more kids and you inspire generations after generations to give back to the community. I feel like as time progresses, the idea of education isn't as glamorous as it may have once been. And so it's important for the kids to realize that without education, you can't really go much further. And education needs strong people who want to give back and who want to do good and who have a passion for whatever they want to teach.
I joined Future Teachers Club because I wanted to become a guidance counselor. And I wanted to take on the role that my teachers in the past did in the guidance counselor because it like offered me a person to talk to and like help guide me in my school career, and I want to be that for kids. My favorite part about the Future Teachers Club is going on to the field trips and seeing all the professors give off like tactics and like strategies to become a good teacher, and seeing all the other schools and all the other kids that want to do the same thing that I want to do, and it just boosted like the morale for it.
The teachers that we're hiring are kids from our community. It's a grow your own. It is supported by the schools, by the teachers, by the businesses, by our community. I know the mayor supports me certainly in these efforts. So we're doing everything we can, but we're asking for the community's help to really make this happen for Brockton. I would ask young people out there, is this the place that you want to be to make a difference? Do you want to work with a young person? Do you want to be that person that assists them in achieving great things? Do you want to be that person that allows our students to excel on the stage, certainly on the athletic fields, in all of the clubs our students, you know, certainly belong to? You are that person out there. And I'm asking you to come back to give of yourself, because you know our community. You know, you're the person that is familiar with what happens in the city of Brockton. And I welcome each and every one of you to come back and truly be part of a wonderful workforce and a wonderful school system. Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name. And they're always troubles are the same. You want to be where everybody knows your name.
I want to thank Lynn Tartaglia, because that really was our students. They were interviewing, they were filming. I think that is just amazing. They did a fabulous job. I look forward to not only coming and seeing them and thanking them for all they do, but also our goal is to be out there in the community sharing this video. If you have a community group, a church group, whatever kind of group, and you can share this message. We want parents talking about education, so that students that are choosing careers, and our Brockton students, you know, choose to go into teaching and come back and teach in the City of Champions. So hopefully years from now, when you look at the Brockton High alumni up there, how many are there? Did you count them, Brockton High? It looked like there were at least 25. And was that just the high school? Yeah, so when you think about the district, you know, we need to really grow that number. So I think it's a good start, and we'll continue to update the the school committee on the diversity task force.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next item.
And the next item, I would like to, well, first of all, I want to, is Jackie Healy here? Is Jackie here? Jackie Healy, Mike Healy's widow, had contacted me recently, and she wanted to share a bit of good news that I thought was important for the school committee to hear. Their oldest daughter, Alana, who graduated from Brockton High and went to Hessen College in Maine, is basically an all-star pitcher and was actually named a pitcher of the week in the North Atlantic Conference, and this was during a 14-game week down in Florida over what would have been their spring break. And I think what's important, and I wanted to share this with the group, is a statement from Alana. And it basically says, "Softball has been a part of my life since I was 5 years old. Through this sport, I have learned many life lessons and met some amazing people. With this season being my last, I am dedicating it to my dad, Michael Healy, my first coach, catcher, and biggest critic. I'm extremely excited to see where this season will bring us with the talent that Husson University has on the team this year. And that is a quote from Alana Healy. She is co-captain of Husson Eagles softball team. And I thought, knowing Mike being a member of our school committee from Ward 6, and just a great guy and an entertaining guy, to say the least, and I know how proud he would be of both his daughters. Certainly Catherine is a junior at the high school, sophomore at the high school? Sophomore at the high school, and I just want to congratulate Alana and Jackie for bringing that to our attention.
Very nice.
And next, I would like to invite Kelly Jones down here, our bilingual department head, and she is going to do an update on bilingual services in the district.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having me tonight for an update. The last time I was here to talk about the bilingual department was in February of 2016, so I'm going to give you some comparisons of where we were in 2016 and what's happened in the last couple of years. The first slide is our mission and vision. I'm not going to go over it. I'm not going to read it out for you. You have it, but I want to highlight a couple of things. For example, English learners are not homogeneous. We provide programming for all school-aged children from all languages, cultural backgrounds, and academic backgrounds. We also have a bilingualism as an asset central to our vision, that the ability to speak more than one language is a valuable asset, and that students will cultivate this ability in a rigorous, yes, supportive and understanding environment. Essential to our mission in the bilingual department is our parent engagement. It is the strategic plan of the district, goal number 3, community engagement, for which I am the goal owner. It is also required by Title III. We have to provide for parent engagement opportunities. So this year, we've been able to provide 7 parent academy workshops in the languages of the students. So we've provided in Portuguese, Cape Verdean, Haitian, French, and Spanish. And these are some of the nights that we've had. We are having the Haitian flag celebration and the International Night of Portuguese Language and Culture in May. Through our immigrant grant, we were able to have 3 part-time bilingual ELL parent advocates. They've been essential to building that bridge between the school and the community and providing support to families who reach out for need. We have a bilingual PAC, and we've had two events. One, we had an immigration attorney on March 23rd come and speak, where we had close to 300 community members and parents come. And tonight, we're actually having the bilingual family game night at the Arnone School, and we have about 50 participants there. We were also able to provide an adult ESOL program, 6 classes with 14 weeks of instruction for over 125 parents of our students. We were able to include a computer lab component, as well as provide enrichment support for the students of those parents. So those parents could bring their students, their children to this event. They would have a literacy development while their parents were taking classes. This graph is something we're all familiar with. It's been since 1972. Brockton is the first bilingual program in Massachusetts. And you can see we had a very kind of slow and steady growth until 2008, where we jumped immeasurably. What do we know? We know that between 2008 and 2009, 1 year, our English learner population grew by 51.6%. And then next year, it grew between another 33.8%. In all, between 2008 and 2014, the English learner population increased by 115.8%. So that's till 2014. Where are we today? The last time I saw you, we had 3,502 English learners. Now, this is always a point in time because we always have new students entering into the district, and every year we have students exiting English learner status. So this is just a point in time. So we had 3,502 in January 27th in 2016. Today, on March 28th, that was when I looked up the data, we had 3,682. So that's an addition of 180 students who are English learners in the district. That is despite the fact that we have had people exiting English learner status. I don't want you to think that we've only had 180 new students because we have students exiting English learner status. You can see that our formerly English learner status has increased as well. That is 85. And then the fully exited, those are students who have been exited from the formerly English learner status, and we no longer have to monitor them, but it's the next couple of years. So you can see that we are a growing population. Where do our students come from? 2020, so 54% are Cape Verdean, 19% are Haitian, 15% are Spanish, 5% are Portuguese, 2% are Vietnamese, and then we have the other. 2.8% are the other students. And so those include our Quechuan speakers who participate in our Spanish program, and our low incidence languages such as Urdu, Arabic, Chinese. We have over 30 languages represented in Brockton. And you can see this is just a graphic representation of where these students are. So I think it's notable that Cape Verdean, Haitian contribute almost 75% of our total population. So every spring, English learners take access. Last year in 2016, it was the first time that of a new version of the test, Access 2.0, and some were done online. Last year we had none online. And so this is where our students performed at. Okay, level one being the earliest proficiency level, level six being the highest proficiency level. And students are rated on each of their domains, listening, speaking, reading, and writing, and given an overall composite. This is their overall composite score. Now, these numbers don't include the students who arrived to our district after February 1st of 2016. We just had the 2017 access conducted in January, and unfortunately we will not get the results from DESE until on or around May 31st. You can see a bar graph showing where the students perform. And I want to kind of highlight this level six, because this level six looks very, very small. But the reality is students become eligible for possible reclassification in level five. So the majority of our students exiting English learner status and moving into formally English learner status is done at level five. So these level six are our performers who kind of jump from level four to level six in 1 year. Now, the district, until 2016, we were given an accountability scores based on three elements. We have what's called, or we had what's called AMMO, Annual Measurable Achievement Objective. And we have three areas that we had to look at. One was progress towards English proficiency. Are they making growth towards English proficiency? And that's for 2015 and 2016. You can see that we exceeded our target set by the state. In 2016, we exceeded it by 8 points. So we did meet the target. The second AMMO is our attainment of English proficiency. Are our students achieving English proficiency? That's that level 5. Our target each year was 20, and you can see that we exceeded it both years. And in 2016, we exceeded it by 2 points. The third AMMO is performance on MCAS and PARC in the English learner, formerly English learner subgroup. This is an assessment designed and tested and normed on English-speaking, English-proficient students. So we did not meet the target of 75 each year, but you can see that we have increased between 2015 and 2016 from a 55 to a 59. Required by the state and the federal government is that we need to have a language assessment team meeting each year to review student progress in attaining English and make recommendations about programming and instruction for them. And what we see if we look at just our K-8 sampling is that it aligns really closely to what we know about language acquisition. Language acquisition, the research says, to gain proficiency in academic language, it can take 5 to 7 years, up to 10 years if students do not have the opportunity to become literate in their first language. And that is a portion of our population. So you can see that the fourth column over, percentage in SC, SEI, TBE, that's self-contained SEI, you can see the highest percentage is 64% in kindergarten in a self-contained program, and that goes down to 44% in grade 8. So not all of our kids are in substantially separate type programs. Many of them are in our integrated programs and receiving ESL instruction in a pull-out basis. And you can see that from that percentage, we integrate 41% of our students in grade 3 from those programs, aligning to the language acquisition research, another 38% in grade 4, and then 46% in grade 5. 62% of 8th graders last year were integrated into ISEI or reclassified. And the last columns are those about being reclassified into formally English learner status, and that aligns with what we know. It takes 5 to 7, up to 10 years to become proficient, comparable to native English-speaking peers. And we reclassify 24% of students in grade 3, 16% of grade students in grade 4, 17% of grade students in grade 5. You know, Brockton is, as the city of champions, Brockton is also the champion of English learner education. Brockton is a state and national model for the programs and processes that we offer its students. And you can see we had a wide range of visitors, national, Utah State Board of Education, international, Kindai University of Japan, came to learn about what are the processes and the programs that we have established that meet the needs of students from different proficiency levels and academic preparation. We started the UNIDOS Portuguese Immersion Program. That has been a great interest to states and districts. We are hosting Pawtucket very soon to take a look at our UNIDOS program because they want to start a Portuguese dual language program in Pawtucket. I also presented with the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education our ESL curriculum. We've been working very closely with the model curriculum project with DESE, and I presented at the National WIDA Conference in 2016 and at the state convening in 2017. I just found out a couple of weeks ago that Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is featuring Brockton for innovative and responsive programs for immigrant and refugee students in the instructional support newsletter next month. It's not out yet, so I can't tell you exactly what they're saying, but they are highlighting Brockton as the featured district in that state newsletter. Now, moving forward, like special education, English learner education has a multitude of compliance requirements. This is ESSA, as has certain requirements, as well as the Department of Justice work with the Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. Through these compliance requirements include things like state requirements and uniform requirements for identification, programming, reclassification of English learners, and a preschool assessment which we never had to do before. They also require different levels of ESL for its students given on their WIDA proficiency level. So if students are level 1 to low 3s, they need to receive 2 to 3 periods, and a period being no less than 45 minutes of direct ESL instruction delivered by a licensed ESL teacher a day. They need to, if they're high 3s through level 5s, they need 1 period of no less than 45 minutes per day of direct ESL instruction. And at the same time, programs for English learners have 2 requirements, ESL and sheltered content. So we have to have this differentiation for their proficiency level. At the same time, we must provide them access to grade level content and standards. And moving forward, Access 2.0, we piloted the online version in 6 schools this year, and we will have to have all of them online by 2019. The Department of Justice is still in Massachusetts, and it's involved in a variety of schools. Just a few months ago, the newspapers reported that they were involved with Braintree and Lawrence. Particularly about their lack of translation and interpretation services. But we know once the Department of Justice enters a system, it does not just look at that one citation, it looks at everything. So that's a change from the last year when I presented. And in 2018, we will be having our mid-cycle site review by DESE. That was our coordinated program review. That's not just English learner education, but special education and civil rights and vocational education as well. But they'll be coming next year to do their mid-cycle site review to see how we're doing on our coordinated program review action plan. Any questions? Sure.
Many don't realize this, but I was English was not my first language.
So I am a product of this program dating back to probably the early 80s. So I remember Mrs. Nakamoto over at the Brookfield School, and I'd sit with her, and you know, it was hard. And I think this is wonderful, and I think honestly reaching out to the parents so they can better understand what the students are going through.
Right.
That makes a huge difference.
Right.
So this is wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're doing a great job here. We were the first ones to do it. When we're talking about budget cuts, mm-hmm. Now I'm assuming we would have to be mandated, just as we can't make so many cuts from our special ed department. Is this department pretty much protected from hitting any drastic cuts?
I can say we have compliance requirements,
okay.
Just like special education. The system's going to have to make some difficult decisions. We do have compliance requirements. We do know that DESE is going to be coming back next year, and we do know that the DOJ is right next door.
How are we doing with our compliances so far? mentioned one, I know, yes.
So the English learner education, we were cited in four separate criteria. That's pretty good. Three of them have been kind of remedied. We're still working on the final, which is ESL licensing. So out of our kind of citations, we've got three out of the four all settled.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So as you saw with your special education, and one of the reasons when we talk about some of the moves we made were, again, this coordinated program review, they come back into the district. And if they require you to make changes, if you don't, the program, again, has implications. So we continue to work. Kelly and her team, they've done an excellent job responding to the coordinated program review and to the corrective action plan, which continues to be looked at. As you said, mm-hmm. the mid-cycle review
yes.
will be in
2018.
And the other thing, and you bring up, Joyce, the parent involvement. I think it's clear to people, and it was brought up last night, actually, even at our diversity task force meeting, was, you know, what are we doing with the state of our immigration population and the things that children are hearing, families are hearing, and moving forward, what are we as a district doing? And back on the 21st of March, we did have a planned, and I think I talked about it, a planned academy for our parents and community members. We had close to 300 people attend.
Yeah.
We did not take names. We weren't sure if four people were going to show or if up to 300 were going to show up. We had an immigration attorney who talked about rights as residents of Brockton, residents of this country.
Mm-hmm.
Again, lots of information. We'll continue to try to have workshops. But I also want you to know there is an outreach to make sure that our families feel welcome in every one of our school buildings. We'll continue to do that. We also, I'm working with the mayor. We don't have to develop new policies. Our children are protected. They come to school. The policies protect their information. We've made it very clear through our principals that if anyone were to come into a school, it's directed to the superintendent's office. We'll work with our attorneys, again, to make sure our children can come to school safely. We can educate them academically, socially, emotionally, all of the things that we do for every one of our students, and we'll continue to do that. We do not ask immigration status when students appear at our door. We register them with the mandates that we have for all children, and then we welcome them into our classes and into our programs, and have done that for a lot of years. So I do want to assure the community that the mayor and I are working together. We have a meeting, I think, set up for sometime after April 11th, and we will be reaching out to the community with a statement with our elected officials to really talk about how we operate as a school district and as a city.
Thank you.
Kelly,
Oh, I thought I was done.
This will be quick. A very nice presentation, very thoughtful and thorough. With regard to the trend line,
mm-hmm.
do you have what accounted for the doubling, basically, in the 2008 year? I mean, is there any explanation or?
Well, I know we had the 2010 Haitian earthquake, and that had an impact. We had a large population. Our Haitian population doubled in about a 6 to 8 week time period. It was a very small, stable population. But I don't know. I know that after September 11th, you can see the trend really leveled off a bit. And I don't know if there was some national policy that kind of had some impact on that. But I do know that in 2008, 2009, we you know just had an explosion of new residents to Brockton.
Yeah, just curious.
Yeah, anything I could say was all conjecture. I have no hard fact.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mark.
Two quick comments. One is, first of all, congratulations to you and your team on the great program you've put together. One of the things that I really like to see in here was that you had the adult component.
Mm-hmm.
I have a lot of constituents who themselves English is a second language, and their children are certainly English language learners. And so I'm really happy to see that there's an adult component here.
thankfully, we received an immigrant grant this year. We've always been able to, the last couple of years, we've been able to have some form of adult ESL, even if it's one or two classes. But the fact that we had an immigrant grant from the state enabled us to have the part-time English learner immigrant advocates, right, as well as the adult ESL. And, you know, we had 170 people show up and want to take part, but we just couldn't take them all. We didn't have the staffing.
Right, right.
There's a need out there.
Yeah. And just kind of a general comment, you know, I think it's great that DESE is featuring Brockton for, you know, innovation and you know, with our immigrant and refugee students, and then at the same time clobbering us financially, which, yeah, is what gives us the ability to do the very thing they're recognizing us for, yeah, to do or for doing. So it's kind of a mixed message from them. Mm. But great job.
Thank you.
Oh.
Thank you.
Great presentation.
Thank you.
It was all positive, except for the MCAS and the PAC testing. What do you think that is? Is that,
well,
not enough equipment to?
Well, it's not an assessment that's designed for English learners. You know, if they were proficient in English, and if you look at our FEL data, once they're proficient in English, they equal or sometimes outperform the kind of the composite performance of it. So because those assessments are not designed for English learners, they're taking in the assumption that you are English proficient in those tests, it doesn't surprise me that that we did not meet that goal. What I'm heartened to see and what I am glad to see is that we're always making improvement. So students can achieve academically, even if they're a language learner, and we're teaching them grade level standards and content. And once they achieve English proficiency, they perform academically comparable to the rest of the Brockton student body.
Thank you. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly.
Definitely no? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Minicello, I'm going to let you introduce our last presenter of the evening.
Last but definitely not least is the principal of the Hancock School, Mr. Stephen Shaw. Mr. Shaw, please come down.
So what we've been trying to do is to make sure that we put in front of you what's happening day to day in our schools and to kind of highlight some of the different flavors happening in all of our schools. And we've had a number of presentations. And this will be our Hancock School.
And accompanying Mr. Shaw is Allison McDonald,
the star of our video,
a key component with regard to some of the productions here at the high school.
Yeah.
So are you going to plan to sing tonight for us?
No.
She has a wonderful voice.
So does Mr. Shaw.
Yes, well.
Well, we do not have a duet plan.
Actually, we can do that instead.
Let me say this. Mr. Shaw is the beloved principal of the Hancock School. He has made the school since he's been there. We had a wonderful principal prior to him coming, but since he's been there, he is a very warm person, as you can see. He's one of the best dressed principals in the district. He makes people feel very comfortable. The school has a very balanced and friendly tone to it. I believe it benefits the students. I believe the parents feel very comfortable and safe bringing their children to the Hancock. He has wonderful staff. Like I said, Ms. McDonald is here. She's the teacher representative of the PTA. They both do a very nice job at our PTA meetings. And just to show parents and people at home that he is beloved. We do have a number of members of the PTA here supporting Mr. Shaw. So you
I think you had a very warm welcome. Oh, and we have more members of the PTA and students. I mean, this gentleman just shines at the school. So
you've covered everything, Mr. Minicello, so I think we're done here.
Am I good? I mean, what else can I do for you, Mr. Shaw?
No, that's quite good.
The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I want to say good evening to Superintendent Smith and to Mr. Minicello. Thank you for that warm welcome and school committee welcome. I feel welcome, and thank you for having me here. I brought with me grade 2 teacher Ms. McDonald. I'll put her on the spot up here. Ms. McDonald is involved in so many of the different initiatives throughout the school. It really makes the Hancock School, Allison, and so many of the other teachers what the Hancock School is. So we figured we'd come here today and just share a little bit about our school to you, kind of a snapshot, because a lot of you don't get into the schools often. So we will do the best we can to kind of introduce the school to you, and if you have any questions after, let us know. Ms. Sullivan, how are you? Nice to see you. We go back about 20 years, the old Ashfield School. I do want to thank Allison for being here. Mrs. Keene, thank you for being here, president of my PTA. Mrs. Westerlin, a parent. Mrs. Erickson is here as well. Nice to see you. Mrs. Colombo brought Brianna and Victoria, two of my star students. Thank you for being here. Did I cover everybody? I think so.
Oh, Mrs. Erickson.
Yeah, I saw Mrs. Erickson.
Okay.
Yes. Oh, Mrs. Sinkowitz is here. Well, always in our heart. Once a Hancock School parent, always a Hancock School parent. So it is nice to see you. Thank you. So what we thought was important is talk about the students, because they are the stars of the school, and they are what makes us function each day, come to work. Of course, it's all about the students, and when troubles arise or different things come up, really need to focus and think about why we are there, why we go to work every day, why we walk through those front doors each day. And if you always bring it down to the students, you can't go wrong. It's all about the students and their success. A little bit about the school here, 1963. I don't quite remember back then, but we have roughly 682 students this year, grades kindergarten through 5, 65 faculty members dedicated to our learning community. And without those folks putting their all into what they do every day, their passion, their drive, their dedication, my job would not be possible. So I cannot thank them enough for all that they do. Mary Beth, how the fire was too big, so it did not open properly, so I apologize for that. But it does start with our teachers, as I said. So we have done some fun activities in the past. Allison can attest to that.
Yes.
Just to try to build morale, team building activities. We've had scavenger hunts. We've done fun things around the holidays. And if you have happy teachers, which things aren't always perfect, I must admit, but for the most part, we all respect each other, and we're there all for the children, and we have fun together, and we learn and we grow from each other. So just some pictures of what we do each day. Not every day we do things like this, but yeah. Where's Mr. Minicello? So I want to talk a little bit about professional learning teams, which is, I thank June Saba-Maguire for introducing professional learning teams to our school and taking a chance on us. And ever since they were introduced to our school, I am so proud of my staff. They've really done an amazing job with professional learning teams. So I just put a little information about professional learning teams. You want to read up there? And as a result, our norms were created, our group meeting norms, which we have at all of our meetings, whether it's small group or whole group. Our norms are always reviewed at the beginning of each meeting, and if necessary, we present our group norms or remind each other of our group norms as we are conducting our meetings, because a lot of times we need to call people back to, you know, why we are there, the focus of that meeting. So through our professional learning teams, we learned how to create our group norms, and my teachers have learned our learning to work together. Something that we really needed to make sure was in place before, and it is a work in progress, is for folks to feel psychologically safe. Allison, do you want to talk a little bit about feeling psychologically safe and the kind of exercises that we did?
Right now,
Are you feeling safe?
Just so that everyone knows that their voice can be heard.
Sure.
Whether you agree or disagree, being respectful to one another and knowing that you can share your ideas and opinions judgment-free.
That's right. Absolutely. So psychological safety is belief that one will not be punished or humiliated from speaking up with ideas, questions, concerns, or mistakes. And that's one thing we find. What teachers do, what they're really, really good at is going into their classrooms, closing the door, and teaching within their four walls. What we don't do enough of is sharing, collaborating, working together. And I'm trying to break down those walls at the Hancock School, which is a challenge because people get stuck in their ways. But if we can learn and grow from each other, that's the best resource right there. We don't need to go to workshops and other places. We have incredible talent right here within the Hancock School and right here within the district. And by the way, Allison and I are both products of the Brockton Public Schools
we
as well.
Mm-hmm.
Went through all the schools here. I'm proud to say.
Yes, I am.
So we did a psychological safety survey with our staff, and the important thing about this to remember is you want to take this maybe twice throughout the year, and the hope is that you will see more people feeling more psychologically safe as you go through the year. We've already done two, Allison.
Yes.
And we will do one more maybe towards the end of the year and one towards September, October, when we come back together. Because if we don't have this piece down, we're doing something wrong, which is okay, but we need to reassess and we need to drive what we're doing so that folks will feel safe. Put a little bit of data in here for you. I believe because of PLTs and the hard work that my teachers have done, that our scores, as you can see from 2015 to 2016, have jumped. And the top is our ELA, MCAS/PARC. And the bottom is also shows growth from 2015 to 2016 in our math, MCAS, PARC results. So we did quite a little bit of a celebration at the school because I wanted the teachers, even though they're small gains, we wanted to celebrate those gains. And that is important to remind them of the hard work that they are doing and to continue doing what they're doing. I wanted to just share a little bit of about some of the other things that we do throughout the day, throughout the school, throughout the year to make the Hancock School special. Mary Beth, will this video, this is a video on the right, will that still work if I click it because of, I'll try it. Okay, that's fine. So what we had on the right was just an example of, we say the Hancock School Pledge every morning and the kids were reciting that. And as a member of the Hancock School community, I pledge to be a good citizen who is respectful, responsible, safe, and kind. And we push those four principles all day long, every day, morning, afternoon. Most of my parents, and you all know about that as well. You hear that all the time. So I ask my teachers each day to talk about being respectful, responsible, safe, and kind. How's that look? How's that sound? Sharing examples with each other. We also have our Good Citizen of the Month, which showcases our respect, responsibilities, respect, safety, and kindness. So we celebrate 28 students each
each month, either recognized by the teacher or by their peers. Nice little write-up is created by, again, the teacher or the peers. And we have a little ceremony in the cafeteria, which is really nice. The kids love it. They have individual pictures taken. Then they'll be on a board in the lobby. And then we also have group picture taken. They get a certificate and a little present as well. So it's a really nice nice event. The kids are very excited about it. You agree?
Yes, they love it.
Something that was implemented 3-4 years ago is PBIS, Positive Behavior Intervention and Supports. So again, if you look at our personal PAW, you see respect, responsibility, safety, and kindness on the PAW. And those are individual PAWs. When we see students going above and beyond, we want to reward that. We want to reward the positive behavior. The bottom PAW is a classroom PAW. So if a classroom is, you know, walking quietly in the hall, doing exactly what they're supposed to do, and really stands out, a teacher, myself, you can give a classroom PAW. And so many classroom PAWs equal prizes.
Every 25 classroom PAWs, yeah.
Correct. And then a teacher will pick maybe a special event to do with the kids. And again, they really work towards this as well. So again, all about the kids here, trying to reinforce that positive behavior. Mr. Menicello, you know the guy on the right, don't you? You recognize him?
Is in that suit.
We'd be, this year we completed our third annual food drive, and kids just really enjoy this event too. And again, we just want to showcase some of the things that we do with our students, and to help them become more involved in the community. And I thank all the parents who have supported us with this event as well. And we donate the food to the Charity Guild on Main Street in Brockton, right around the holidays. So this year we took students with us to see the process, to drop it off. We thought they would get a real lot out of that. And I think we took 10 students with us. And it was a great event. I think we filled up three SUVs with food that we collected over a week and a half. It was a great event. Second annual talent show we just finished this year, last week. It really went over well. I have an amazing music teacher, Christine Chalinsky, and she coordinated the whole thing. So some highlights from the show this year. Again, getting the community involved, getting the students involved. That's what it's all about.
A sellout event, right?
Event, and we have a judge sitting. I'm sitting next to one of the judges. Allison was a judge. It was a tough job. Three judges, straight from Hollywood, they came. Another fun event we do, I celebrate the love of reading, is Read Across America, where the students dress in their PJs for the day, and they drop everything and read in the hallway for a half hour. It's a great event just to celebrate the love of reading. And it's just something different from reading in their classroom or in the, you know, reading corner of the library. So it's a great event. I probably should increase that to twice a year.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Nice event. Many of you are familiar with this event as well, Spaghetti Supper, bringing families together to help those in need. The proceeds from this event go to Children Helping Children, and that money goes to families in need or children in need. Unfortunately, big fire in the city at Madrid Square last week, and two of our families were affected. They are fine, but they are no longer in their apartment, unfortunately. So this money, a lot of times, will be used for families in need, whatever we can do. A lot of times we'll give gift cards or we'll go shopping for the families as well. Something I didn't put in here is a lot of times our students are in need of some food. So almost like a Blessings in the Backpack informal program that we have. My guidance heads that up. And we will give food to students before a holiday, before a long weekend or a regular weekend, just so they can have some snacks, because unfortunately some of our students don't get the nutrition they need during, you know, during the weekend or a holiday. you feel good when they're with us because you know they're eating breakfast and lunch. But unfortunately, it's sad when they come to you and say, you know, I'm so hungry at home, we don't have a lot of food to eat. So we have folks donate food. Again, I did not create a slide for this, but folks will donate food, and then we'll put together little care packages of food for these children to take home for the weekend or a vacation. PTA is responsible for many of these events. We could never do it without the PTA and the parent involvement, but Boost-a-Thon was an event we did last year. I've shaved my head for the event. The kids, again, all about the kids, unlike any other fundraiser we've ever done, where it's usually the parent who gets stuck, you know, with selling cookies or wrapping paper or, you know, some sort of item that maybe people don't necessarily want. So this event through Boost-a-Thon was all about the children. They were, you want to talk a little bit more about that, or?
Well, it was just, there's a week-long kind of celebration beforehand to get all the kids psyched, and there's a competition. We made sure we got pledges from all the 50 states, and kids could win prizes based on how many pledges they would get. And just from an initial pledge, everyone got something, and then, you know, to get a high, you know, it's just a nice competition. And it could be done online, so they could reach out to family and relatives that they don't see, and it could all be done that way. So, and then the culmination of it was this fun run outside where we spent, you know, part of the day running laps, who's had the most laps, getting their shirt signed, you know, dancing, having all kinds of fun, and raising money and feeling good about themselves.
Mrs. Keene, how much money did we raise?
$23,000.
$23,000. This week-long event. It's pretty amazing. I don't know of any other fundraiser that would bring in that kind of money. And through that, through those funds, do enrichment programs for the kids, bring in some different programs. Some of these coming science presentation, science and math presentation for the kids. So they'll do like grade-wide assemblies, which is nice. And the PTA will give us some money to support those programs. Yeah. Something else that the kids really look forward to at the end of the year, Hancock Pride Day, celebrating our community. It's just all sorts of fun. As my assistant principal, Mrs. Ford, on the left, that was one of the events left over from Boost-a-Thon. We told the kids if they raised so much money that we taped Mrs. Ford to the cafeteria wall. And she was a good sport. She did it.
And you got slimed.
I think that's me getting slimed. Yes, on the right there. Thank you, Mrs. Keene. So just wrap it up here. I know it's been a long night. By creating memories for our students, we are shaping good citizens at the Hancock School to show that Brockton kids really, truly do count. It's all about the children. Anyone who's here, Mrs. Keene or Mrs. Westerlin, Mrs. Erickson, Mrs. Colombo, Ms. Sinkwitz, have anything to add to the presentation? Because without your support and my teacher's support, as I said, we could never do what we do each day to make the Hancock School very special. Anything?
Yeah, you do.
Girls, did you like the fun run?
You like it?
Good.
Well, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Excellent. It truly was a flavor of exactly what goes on at the Hancock School, and I want to thank the parents and the students, because it does make a difference with what you're able to offer the students. It isn't just about the academics, that certainly is all of our jobs, but also to have that extra support to build community, to make sure that families are welcome, and children are able to have some of those extra things, not only for all children, but I certainly give you credit for reaching out to those families in need, and I know our schools do that. And the Hancock does it particularly well.
Something Mr. Minicello touched upon at the beginning was the feeling of feeling welcome and warm when you come in. And a true testament to that would be an email I received from a visitor who came to the school. And she picked up on that. And she sent an email. And I sent it to the whole staff because I said, this is because of you and all that you do. And she just mentioned in there that, you know, just the nice feeling she gets when she comes in. She felt so welcome. The kids were so well behaved. The manners, it was evident, she said. and she took the time to write a beautiful email. So I hear things like that, and again, I want to applaud my teachers and my students for that, because it's all about them, and they're the ones who help make the school a special place to be. So thank you.
Thank you.
A wonderful job.
Thank you.
You do have a very compassionate building. You have a wonderful PTA, parents that truly show up. You know, when they need to show up and they give of themselves, and that's why these events are so grand and special, because they truly do give it their all. And one thing about the school that you did touch upon is, you know, children in need. When there is, you know, a child, like at all of our schools, really, you know, you see they don't have mittens, you see they don't have a winter coat, you know, like you said, a child doesn't have, you know, which kids are a little hungry for the weekends. I mean, all those things, with the help of parents, the PTA, you know, there are functions that are scheduled that raise funds in order to provide for the kids that really do need help, and I think, you know, that the values that instills and that the school instills in the students, you know, they go on to, you know, middle school, and you can see that, you know, it builds upon each other. You see that in our high school. We have wonderful students in the high school that you know, the Boxer Buddies, programs like that. I mean, there's a sense of compassion, not only in the Hancock, but in the whole district, that is priceless.
Absolutely. You know?
And we appreciate having you at the Hancock,
thank
and
you.
We appreciate you, Ms. McDonald.
Oh, thank you.
It's a real privilege.
We have a hand.
I just wanted to make one comment with regards to Mr. Shaw and how in the school, he has an office, but you don't usually find him in the office. We were talking about this last night and how he is always in the hallways. He is always throughout the school, checking in on the classrooms, on the kids, the teachers. I mean, you'll always find him throughout the building somewhere in the school. And he's not just one to be sitting in his office waiting for everything to come to him. He's out there taking care of the kids, the teachers, and the needs. And I just wanted to say, just on behalf of him as well, that wonderful, fantastic. Thank you. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Anyone else on the committee? Mr. Sullivan.
I just wanted to thank you. This is it was a fabulous presentation.
Thank you.
And it's plain to see that it's your personality, as well as Ms. McDonald.
Oh, thank you.
That drives that. I wish I could go to that school.
I don't let him in Ward 1. He's got to ask permission.
We have no seats.
What I'm driving at is, it's so nice to see a school like that in Brockton. It makes us all look good.
Thank you.
I just wanted to thank you, because you do a hell of a job.
Thank you so much. You're very welcome. My pleasure.
Mrs. Sullivan.
Well, I just wanted to say, Mr. Minichello, that before he was your beloved, he was our beloved sixth grade teacher at Ashfield School for many years.
That's right.
My children attended there. Dating myself, I look older, but you don't. 2001, maybe?
Sure. I think this is
my
20th.
My daughter's 28. 28?
My 20th year in the system.
Really?
Okay. It was 1997 I started.
After he was at the Ashfield, he was the assistant principal at the Pluff.
Yes, I remember.
And I had to tell my son, who was at the Pluff, that Mr. Shaw would be leaving. It wasn't a happy day in the Minichello household, I can tell you that.
Thank you.
Can I share a talking
sure.
story? My son came to drop Carly off that day at school, and my son had just gone to the Pluff. And I said to explain to him that Carly's principal used to go to the Pluff, and that he was there for there 7 years or 6 years. So I had explained this to him, and I could see the wheels turning in Colin's head. And as we drop Carly off and drive off, and he knew that Mr. Shaw was now the principal at the Hancock, he said, "Wow,
He was at the Plough for a really long time. He must have shaped up to be the principal at the Hancock. He couldn't understand how he was there for so long and then made it to be a principal.
I made it.
I guess it's called seasoned.
Well seasoned. I guess so.
Anyone else? Why don't we just pile on?
Thank you so much. I just want to give a shout out to June Saber McGuire as well, because without her support and the support from Central, again, I would not be able to do my job. And Kathy, that includes you as well. So thank you for everything.
Thank you. Yeah.
And good job.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Okay. Superintendent Smith?
Yeah, let me do the budget update. We did have a finance subcommittee meeting before our regularly scheduled school committee meeting this evening. I just want to review that in looking at our figures, I was able to meet with the mayor. And again, this is a work in progress, but we are facing a $16 million deficit in the budget for this year. We've gone to work on that deficit right now. We are looking at everything from transportation to another possible school closing. We'll continue to work on our advocacy with all our elected officials, and we'll continue to update you very quickly as we continue to move through our budget work. Again, we'll keep you updated.
Okay. Is that Mr. Tom Monahan up there?
It is.
Oh, well, let's just recognize Councilor Tom Monahan is in the room from Ward 2. Good to see you, Councilor. Next item.
And items to refer to subcommittee. As you remember back, it seems like ages ago, we had started to work on our policy manual. I felt very strongly that needed a complete review. We brought it forward. There were some questions. We had started off with actually the school committee part of the policy manual. And what we would like to do is schedule the next meeting for Wednesday, April 12th. Wanda will connect with all of you. We have the opportunity to have Jim Hardy in attendance from MASC. We'll go back to working on that section of the policy manual so we can start to move forward with all of the other areas. Our goal was to have that reviewed completely going into August and starting our school year. And I'd like to put that back in the hands of the different departments, bring them for your review, and start that process again.
And at that meeting, can we address a situation that Mr. D'Agostino has with respect to policy that night? Okay.
The 12th is next Wednesday.
Perfect. Okay. So we'll address the item that you'd like to address with regard to policy on Wednesday.
Perfect.
Okay.
Okay.
Anyone else?
Can I just add to that? I don't see the principal. Can we get the facts that are pertinent to that issue?
Yes.
Okay.
So we will have for you the policy that you're looking for is obviously in the student handbook at Brockton High School. It relates to students' attendance at proms as a guest. That seemed to be the area that you were looking at.
Yes.
We look at certainly a student's discipline record. There was some question about what kind of discipline would not allow a student to attend a prom as a guest. So that is specifically the information that you want. So we will look at students that might be affected. We'll get you information on that. So as you review that policy, you'll be able to clearly make some decisions. And I want to be clear that, again, our administration, again, this is something that we do very well. I invite every one of you, if you want to come and see what happens at these proms, I mean, you are talking about 1,000 kids graduating. Now multiply that with a date. We've gone to Gillette, we get letters all the time, and I'm talking Gillette Stadium. We get letters all the time talking about our students, their behavior, the decorum. It is a great time. I really enjoy seeing them. They are inclusive. You have your special needs students. You have your, you know, students that are graduating. It's just a wonderful night and a wonderful memory, and we want to make sure that that is secured for our students. So when these policies were put into place, you know, there really was an assumption that the students that came were worthy of coming. that we would know who those students were in attendance. The teachers come, and we have many teachers that come as chaperones to these events. So I think what we will also include is we'll have, at this meeting, we will have some administration available, and we'll have some discussions as to why the original policy was actually put in there, just to make sure we're making the right decision if you make any changes to that policy.
I'm not sure whether I should go to my son's junior prom. I don't think I'm going to. Yeah,
everybody needs to
be a chaperone.
I don't think
everybody
that's
needs
smart
to
move.
See a prom at Brockton High. Yes. I recommend the senior prom.
Yeah, there you go.
I'll tell you stories about that someday. And before I end, can I just want to end, because this has been two difficult meetings, but I want to end on a fun note. And I want to tell you that I was up at Brockton High School this past week, and I was actually in the shop class downstairs, the carpentry shop, and the students loved showing me. I loved seeing, and I'm sure the women will join me. A couple of the girls were working on shoe nooks. I mean, you had to see this beautiful design of places to put all your shoes in a wooden cabinet. And of course, the young men were working on media cabinets. They were working on Adirondack chairs for outside. They were just beautiful. And one young man looked at me in the end, and he said to me, "Aren't you the superintendent?" And I looked at him, and I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "I saw you in church." I said, "You did?" I said, "What church?" And he said, "Well, that church over there." So I said to him, "Our Lady of Lourdes?" And he says, "Yeah, that's it." And I said, "Well, why didn't you say hi to me?" And he said, "Well, you were praying." So I want to end by saying, all of you join me with prayers at this point, because going forward, it isn't just going to be about advocacy. I think we need to find a new way to move forward. So I just thought that was a great line, that that he didn't want to disturb me because I was praying. So again, it's always fun to be in with our students at any level.
Yes, it is. Anyone have anything under unfinished business? New business? No? I'll just say that the mayor is very much under the weather this evening, and that's why he could not attend. So it's my privilege to fill in for him. Anyone else? How about a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
All in favor? Thank you for attending.